My name is Kim Owen, and I serve as Advanced Applications Coordinator for IT, Central IT here on campus. I work out of the Office of the Vice President of Information Technology. And part of my role involves working with, collaborating with our regional research and education networks, regional, national, and global. And so part of that work, or it is all focused on collaborations that support research and academics. Thus, the reason that we're here. We want to take the opportunity this afternoon to highlight a recent discussion that is emerging and evolving with a university in Greece, and we've got the right people here to tell you about it and to explain in more detail. So I will take a few minutes a little bit later on in the presentation to give you some more detail on, again, why the technology is so important. But first, I'd like to introduce Lisa Hauck from our program, International Programs Office.
Thank you, Kim. Good afternoon, everyone, and I'm really glad to be here. I think that what we're doing today is indicative of what we're doing in many areas when we're connecting with partners, both past, present, and future, overseas. One of the things that that we are always trying to do at NDSU is to do more. To figure out how to do more with less, in a way, if I can say. As you can imagine, it can be quite time-consuming, and in terms of resources, quite daunting to build and maintain international relationships. And so to be able to use technology in this way to maintain, while there's still nothing like having a cup of coffee and meeting somebody face-to-face, we're not able to do that with all of our partners. And so to be able to explore and build international partnerships where we stay here in Fargo and our partners are in Greece or in Pakistan. I'm thinking of that example because yesterday morning at 7 a.m. I was sitting in a EML 183 with some NDSU faculty and administrators talking to counterparts from a potential collaborator in Pakistan. And so that gives you a sense of what we're able to do. And in reality, I think we're just scratching the surface. I'm very excited today also because this particular relationship that's going to be discussed and that we're going to be hearing, I think, from faculty from the University of Thessalonica in Greece is one that I think is very near and dear to many of our hearts, including Cece Rawetter, who's been helping, really been formative in building this relationship. And again, this is something that we find works very well at NDSU, is when you've got someone here that has some sort of a connection, whether it's a home country, a region, family members, or colleagues that are working at another institution, and then a conversation starts, and we start looking at areas where we can collaborate and grow together to do something amazing for our institution, and specifically, I think, for our students in terms of exchanges and things like that. So Cece's been going back and forth to Greece for, probably ever since she's been here, but in the past few years, specifically visiting this university to start conversations about forming a relationship. And in 2012, we were finally able to sign off on a general MOU, a memorandum of understanding. And in the recent few months, what's been emerging is a video conference discussions with interested departments here at NDSU and meeting with counterparts over in Greece through technology to talk about ways that they can collaborate. So this is something that's we've been doing a little bit of. This is taking it to the next level, and we're really excited as we look to expand our international relationships to be able to utilize technology more this way. So I think I'll leave it at that and stick around to hear more.
As Lisa said, the relationship is new and it's being developed right now. And to introduce the NDSU to the NDSU community to Aristotle University, we have a personal greeting from Helen Kotsaki. She is Lisa's counterpart.
Hello. My name is Helen Kotsaki. I am head of the Department of International Relations at Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. On behalf of our rector, Professor Yannis Milopoulos, I would like to send you our wishes for the success of the IT Expo, which North Dakota State University is organizing. We are very happy to have signed a cooperation agreement between our two universities in the year 2012. And since then, we are working together with administrative staff of North Dakota and faculty members in order to explore the possibilities of common cooperation and achieving goals between the two universities. Especially for the IT Expo, we have been very close with cooperators like Sisi, Lisa, Kim, Daniel, and faculty members as well. To all of them, we wish you every success. And we have prepared some materials which are uploaded to the website which you have provided us. The materials present our university, and we hope you will enjoy watching them. Thank you very much. We wish every success, and we'll continue to work together in order to achieve our common goals. Thank you very much.
We told her she had 2 minutes, and if you noticed, she got it right on the button. To get to her office, you get to go past this big, imposing statue of Aristotle. It's pretty awesome. So now, this is some of the material that she said was prepared for us, and it will introduce you a little bit more to the university and to the city, or first the city and then the university. If it seems like a history lesson, yeah, it's a little bit like a history lesson.
History and tradition is one of the most important cities in the Eastern Mediterranean. It was founded in 316 BC and developed continually over the course of time into a city rivaling Constantinople in the Byzantine era and into a major administrative and commercial center during the post-Byzantine era. It was protected by walls, large parts of which are still preserved today, and by fortresses such as the White Tower and the fortresses of Eptapyrgio and Vardari. It welcomed peoples and ethnic groups that settled here and were integrated, thereby lending a cosmopolitan character to the city. Important social and political movements often began in Thessaloniki. Intellectual and artistic life has always been strong here, as is attested by the preserved texts of various scholars and the ecclesiastical and secular monuments of each era. Today, Thessaloniki is a modern 21st century city, the second largest city in Greece. The current city, its major international port and its industrial area, has developed around the historical center. The sites in the historical center, the old neighborhoods in the upper city, the intellectual life and tradition, and the many cultural activities unite the past with the present and future. The Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. Eleftherios Venizelos was the first to realize the need to establish a university in Thessaloniki immediately following the liberation of northern Greece. The difficult circumstances of that period, however, did not permit the publication of the Founding Act until 1925 by the then Prime Minister, Alexandros Papanastasiou. And so the university opened in 1926, located first in the Alatini building, and then relocated the following year in the historical building known in the city as the Old Philosophy Faculty. That same year saw the founding of other faculties in addition to the Faculty of Philosophy. Gradually, the university expanded with the addition of new and necessary faculties and schools. In this way, it has come today to comprise 12 faculties and 4 independent schools. It is the largest university in Greece, boasting more than 90,000 students and over 4,000 academic, research and administrative staff members. Its campus is situated on 43,000 square meters of land in the city center, while a number of its facilities are located off campus. Studies and projects in the Aristotle University. Today, the Aristotle University is a modern and versatile institution with diverse aims and goals. All its 42 schools engage in education and research, produce technical expertise, and promote scientific and artistic developments. At the same time, its involvement in the social and cultural life of the city and of the country in general is particularly vigorous and lively. Most of its students, whether home or foreign students, continue their studies after graduation, enrolling for master's and PhD programs, many of which are interdepartmental or involve cooperation with other universities, both in Greece and abroad. A number of prominent and internationally renowned scholars are listed among its academic staff. With the help of young researchers, applications, methodologies and formulas providing solutions to current social, scientific and practical issues are being developed in its laboratories and workshops. At the Aristotle University, science is not pursued purely for its own sake. Activities on campus. All the academic and administrative coordination takes place in the administration building, which houses the means and resources necessary for the university's operation. The Aristotle University boasts one of the most extensive libraries in the Balkans. The central library, located in its own building, along with the various departmental libraries, constitute an integrated system also accessible via the internet. Thus, members of the academic community are able to keep up to date with both Greek and foreign bibliography. In addition, there is the Student Union, which caters for the needs of everyday student life. Apart from housing the refectory, the union offers healthcare services, as well as opportunities for artistic, cultural, and athletic activities. Student social clubs engaging in drama, visual arts, music, films, sports are active in all schools. These clubs present their work during student week. Performances and presentations are open to the public in Thessaloniki. Also notable is the contribution of the Aristotle University Orchestra and Choir, made up of students, to the artistic life not only of the university, but also of the city. One of the most cheerful sights on campus, without doubt, is the Children's Daycare Center, where both employees and students can leave their children in safekeeping. Students in the city. There is an intense and lively student presence in Thessaloniki. Those who are away from their hometown find accommodation either in the student residences or, in most cases, in apartments and studios all over the city. Students are everywhere in the city and are actively involved in its daily life, participating in the events organized by the city's numerous cultural and artistic organizations. Cafes, tavernas and clubs are the spots where students hang out and have fun, yet they also frequent the theaters and cinemas, attend the festivals, music shows, concerts and art exhibitions. Through just a stroll around the city with its many monuments, the contact of students with our cultural heritage becomes an easy and natural experience. In Thessaloniki, the relationship between the university and the city is reciprocal, stimulating, and productive.
Just a little piece of life in the other part of the world. Speaking of the other part of the world, some time ago, quite a few years ago, there was a commercial about something being the next best thing to being there. And today, technology makes the next best thing to being there possible. And to talk more about that are Kim Owen, whom you've met already, and Daniel Erickson, Interactive Technology Consultant from our IT division.
Okay, as I was saying before, one of the roles that we do from central IT standpoint at NDSU and also from other campuses across North Dakota is to support researchers and research and academics in collaborations across our state, across our country, and around the world. And so to do this, we have relationships and memberships in some research and education networks. You heard Mark Wallman, our VP of IT, this morning talking about Internet 2. Also, a regional network that is connected to Internet 2 is our Northern Tier Network Consortium that spans from the states across from Chicago all the way to Seattle. These are high bandwidth networks that are dedicated specifically for the use of research and academics, and so it doesn't have all the traffic and all the extra media things clogging it that we know and love on our typical commodity internet. And that's a real simplified explanation of something much more technical. But just to give you an idea of the kinds of things that the research and education networks do is, as I said, the high bandwidth connectivity that is open and clear for use in order to transport the huge data sets, the amount of media that's involved in collaborations, just-in-time collaborations, whether you're talking science, whether you're talking arts and humanities, music, those types of things. That's something that the R&E networks can do. And they create bridges for virtual collaborations. Now, that's the network piece. There's a lot of technology applications that ride on top of those that can be very beneficial. And one of the things that we wanted to do today through this presentation is to demonstrate to you some of those tools that are available to all of us through licenses that we have, application licenses that we have available through NDSU and through the state. So as you're listening to this and as you hear more about what Daniel's going to talk to you about with some of these applications, think about things that you're currently doing that you know your students are doing or your colleagues in your department, and the kinds of things that they might be doing in it when it comes to collaboration, working with colleagues either on research projects, dedicated research, or academic activities that are going on. So whether it's universities, like I said, regionally, or much farther abroad or globally. In addition, especially in our state and in many states in the U.S., we have the ability to connect in with K-12s. And so if you've got outreach happening or research that's going on with K-12 teachers or students, we can work with you to get those connections ensured. Governmental research laboratories, we have many across the U.S. that are also involved with Internet 2 and have access to these networks. And then organized, not-for-profit, government or ministry-based across the country, across the world, with other types of research centers that are working on the same types of things. And again, I'm crossing the boundaries of PowerPoint protocol here with so many words, but the benefits are that they can support our work with our networks can support all the different kinds of things that are so vital to our university community, and the connectivity becomes transparent. As Mark showed with that big iceberg, the big piece of it that's underwater, that's part of the infrastructure that's available, and it's not something that you have to think about when you're going to launch a research project. You can collaborate virtually, you can share those scientific data sets regardless what type of discipline you're in, and also utilize those different types of instruments, high-end instruments, remotely as needed. And the color, just to give you an idea of the other collaborators that we have around the world, this is just a visual of the global map, and the darker colored areas are the ones, the countries that are involved in some kind of regional education network activity. You'll notice that there's some big gaps still in Africa, but those are being worked on as we speak, and they're gaining momentum as time goes on. And so we want to talk about the tools and the resources that run on top of that network, and that's where Daniel's going to step in. And please notice that we will be scheduling a follow-up session to this presentation today so that we can get you in and have you practicing some of these tools and give you some hands-on experience with them so that you actually get an idea of if it works and what you could use it for.
Hi, my name is Daniel Erickson. I'm the interactive media consultant here at NDSU. And initially we were hoping to have some of these connections with the university in Greece actually through some of these tools that I'm going to talk about, but it's really not the tools but the time difference that made that not workable for us, unfortunately. So I'm going to talk about the tools that we have used in the collaboration, some of the tools that are available to all of you through licensing that is provided to us as part of the NDUS license. So these are tools that are available to you at no cost that you can utilize, and your partners, if you do have international collaborations, can access them as well. Okay. If you have ever used any kind of video conference application such as Skype or Google Hangout, this will kind of look familiar, except that there's a couple of things here that you'll note. Instead of a one-to-one video conference connection, you have multiple parties connecting into this. So, I don't know if you can hear me, I'll try to speak up. So you have multiple partners calling into one video conference connection, and one of them is sharing their computer screen, and all of these parties would be able to share any kind of content that they have on their computer with everybody in this connection, so it can be very interactive collaboration. The name of the software is Qualcomm Real Presence Desktop. This software, in addition to allowing you to have multiple parties and sharing the content, also has mobile applications and connects to any of our video conference rooms or any other video conference rooms around the world that other universities or businesses might have. So these are some of the features, some of the advantages of using this software rather than maybe having a connection with Skype or Google Hangout or just emailing back and forth or having the phone call here and there. You have both PC and Mac support. The interface is consistent, so if you move between devices, PC, Mac, maybe your tablet or your smartphone, it'll all look very, very similar, and making calls and connecting with your partners will be seamless between the different devices. Security is a concern with firewall traversal, being able to access endpoints that are behind firewalls and encryption of the connection. This makes it a very secure application, rather than going over commodities internet with an application like Skype. So this is a very large benefit if you have any kind of materials or content that you want to make sure is protected. Dual monitor support and then the full HD video and content are huge if you need to share materials and have a very lifelike interaction with your partners. Especially the dual monitor support, not being able to go maybe into a video conference room, but being at your computer, having the ability to see content and the video of the parties on different screens, and having that real estate to really see clear pictures of the participants and the content is essential a lot of times. Here are a couple more pictures. I think images are really good. I was hoping to bring up an actual call, an actual presentation with some of our rooms, but we're probably not going to have the time for that. So I'm going to try to put up some pictures. So this is both an Android and an Apple iOS device connecting, again, to multi-point video conferences. And even on these devices, you're able to receive content shared by other parties, and you can share content that you have on that device. And the same with the Android platform. You see all the parties in the call, you see all the content, you can use both front and rear cameras. So really you have a lot of flexibility, and this works on wireless or on your data networks. So you can take this device and connect from basically anywhere in the world to anybody in the world. And making the connections, a lot of times it seems like it's difficult, maybe a bit of a hassle to come up with these connections and talk to somebody else, where an email or a phone call is so much easier. Really, with this application, you have two basic ways of making connections. You can set up your address book, and that way you would have all of your contacts right there in the application. And all you do is you just bring up the contact that you want to call, you click on them, you hit dial, and they will receive the call from you. Or you can enter a number if you're setting up a multi-point call, or if you're calling into a video conference room. All you need is that address, and you just type it right into your dial pad, and you get connected to whatever call or whatever party you're trying to reach. So really, the ease of use, the security, the convenience, and the ability to connect with people on just regular phones, smartphones, tablets, computers, video conference rooms, makes this a very useful application, I think, for a lot of people trying to collaborate with people in the state, in the country, or worldwide. In addition to being able to use this on a laptop, a mobile device, we obviously have video conference, more traditional video conference rooms here than is here as well. And this will give you a really high quality experience, multiple screens for you to view content and video, ceiling hung mics that pick up a very clear audio. So these are other rooms that we have available that connect to mobile devices, to laptops in these multi-point calls. So in addition to being able to use this mobile and on the go, you can also reserve these rooms, again, at no cost and connect to anybody. And I know some of the presentations that we'll see later on have utilized some of these rooms for their collaboration, so you'll hear some more about that. That I'll hand it off to the next presenter. I hope that gives you a very brief overview of some of these tools. Yes?
What do you have to do to set it up?
You can contact me and I can get you all of the information that you need. For some of the mobile applications for Apple iOS devices or Android devices, you can even just go to the App Store and under Polycom Real Presence, you can just download the application. It doesn't require anything. But I would be your contact if you need to set up an account, maybe get some help getting this installed.
And if somebody working in a company, for example, in Germany, wanted to use it with us, are there any restrictions?
No, there are no restrictions. As long as they work with somebody here within the university system, we have a couple of different ways we can set this up. Again, if they have a video conference room, we can connect. If they want to use it on their laptop, there's something called the Cloud Access, which is something else that's going to come out that doesn't require accounts to be created. They will just simply follow a link and be logged into a multi-point call. Or we can create an account for them, maybe a more regular collaboration between a couple of individuals. So we can create an account and have it set up that way. Then you can use the address book feature. So just contact me and I'll get you set up and we can talk about it. Any other quick questions? Thank you.
Communication is a vital component of all collaborations in all disciplines. And when collaborations reach across borders, there's an added element of complexity. Speaking the same language is not always as simple as it seems. NDSU has been involved for some time in fascinating work about educational writing and translations made possible by the use of various technologies. And to speak about this project is Massimo Verzella, graduate teaching assistant at NDSU. Massimo received his PhD in English language and literature from the University of Chieti Pescara in Italy. In 2012, he enrolled in NDSU's PhD program in English rhetoric, writing, and culture with the aim of connecting literary and linguistic studies and branch out into other areas that fascinate him, from technical writing to translation theory. Massimo?
Okay, so this project I'm talking about today was created by Bruce Mela and another teacher from Belgium, Sonia van de Pitte, in the year 2000. And the project gradually started as a bilateral project, but then it gradually expanded into a more complex project involving more than two countries. So it became a multilateral project. So right now, the countries involved are highlighted in red here. So the states, we have in Europe Spain, France, Belgium, Italy, and Finland. And we have just started collaborating with China too this semester. You can see two arrows on the screen because texts and documents travel in two directions. So there is a west to east direction and an east to west. So American students sometimes create documents which are then translated by European students. In other cases, the European students create documents which are sent to the States for American students for revision and editing. So those are the two main directions in which the text travel. This is the main goal for the transatlantic project. So the most important one is to share insights into collaborative writing across borders and cultures. And of course, there are plenty of secondary goals. My opinion, one of the most important is to gain knowledge of each other's cultural basis, to understand foreign cultures, to be able to improve one's skills in intercultural communication. So those are the main goals. And this is a flowchart I created to illustrate how the project works. Okay, it's a complex project, so I hope my flowchart will be useful to understand what we do. So this is the West to East project. Okay, in this case, American students co-write a set of instructions with Spanish students in Barcelona, Spain. So they co-write instruction and then they prepare these instructions for translation. Once they prepare the instruction for translation, they send the translation, the instructions to Belgium, France, and Italy. And as students in this country start translating, they get in touch with American students to understand and to negotiate the text, to understand how they can translate particular bits which are difficult or not easy to understand. So there is this exchange, this constant exchange between American students and European students. The very last phase, the last stage in the project, is sending the instructions to Finland, to students in Finland who run a usability test on the instruction to see if the instructions are really usable, see if they are user-friendly and easy to understand. So this is the West to East project. And this second one is the East to West project. So in this case, the European students translate an article in their local languages into English, and then they send the article to American students for revision and editing. Okay, so in this case, American students act as language experts. Once again, there is a process of text negotiation, and students keep in touch, they collaborate, and they use several technical devices, technological devices, to constantly exchange ideas and information. So some of them, I included this document just to show how complex this kind of project is. There are many phases involved in the process. And students have to consider many differences across cultures. They have to consider the time difference, of course, between the States and Europe and also China. They also have to consider different holidays. So sometimes, for example, Italian students are unavailable because they're on holiday. American students start their classes in August, okay? In August in Italy, there is not only a government shutdown, but there is a kind of a mental shutdown, okay? So it's hard to reach Italian students in August. So there are many issues that students have to consider as they try to collaborate, as they cooperate across cultures. And Yeah, these are some of the technologies used by our students and students in Europe and China. Writing programs, of course, Word with editing tools, PowerPoint, Excel, MS Publisher. A platform we constantly use is Google Drive. Google Drive allows students to co-write documents and to exchange ideas and in real time. Email, of course, Skype, Facebook, and we also had a video conference, Daniel, last year, and it was very successful. I think we were communicating with four foreign countries: Italy, France, and Belgium. So three, probably.
Finland
too. Yeah. So video conference was extremely useful to see the students we were collaborating with and to get in touch with them. And among the tools we use, this is one that we are using more and more because it's an alternative to dictionaries, and it's the Corpus of Contemporary American English, a corpus of 550 million words. So it acts like a dictionary, but it's more than that. It allows students to figure out if a sentence or an expression or a phrase is conventional in English. It's standard in English. So standard means used in this case. So it's very useful at the stage of the revision of the instruction. Okay. So this is one of the new tools we're trying to have our students use, and also European students. Okay, that's all I have. I don't know if there are questions about the project.
We will have more opportunities to discuss this project early next month, and you all have information in the little cards you received. Thank you, Massimo. Scholarship and research and their impact on society are now communicated on a global level, as we learned. And that makes the field of journalism and mass communications of critical importance. And to introduce Aristotle University School of Journalism and Mass Communications, one school who is already very active in collaborating with our local school here, is Dr. Marina Zanopoulou. She was actually referred to us by one of our faculty members who met her at a conference in Vienna. It is a small world.
Hello, North Dakota State University. Greetings from Thessaloniki and from the School of Journalism and Mass Communications of the Aristotle University. I'm Marina Zanopoulou, the Academic Coordinator for European International Programs, and I'm here at the Electronic Media Laboratory to introduce our school to you and to give you a brief outline of our programs and facilities. The School of Journalism and Mass Communications was established in 1991. It is housed in a six-story neoclassical building in the center of the city, near the university campus, at the area of the Old Market, which is a very lively place to be, especially for students of journalism who always want to be at the heart of events. Our school offers a balanced blend of courses, compulsory as well as elective. Currently, we offer two study programs. An undergraduate one in the directions of journalism and mass communications, and a graduate one in the directions of journalism and new media and communication and culture. Both of them are taught in Greek, but we also have a very successful international program in English for our exchange students. We also offer PhD programs. More than 500 students study in our school. Our students actively participate in internship programs, both in Greece and abroad, which qualifies them for employment in the public and private media sectors. We also encourage the cooperation of students with local and national media. Our students produce radio and television programs, which are aired during prime time on our national broadcasting service. They also edit a weekly electronic newspaper, which is hosted on our website. The facilities of the school include the library, as well as the Media Informatics Laboratory and the Electronic Media Laboratory. Both laboratories are fully equipped. The Electronic Media Lab includes a sound recording studio, a TV studio, and a control room. The school cooperates through the Erasmus program with 38 European countries and in 20 countries of the European Union, thus contributing to the overall student and staff exchange program. We are one of the very few schools of Aristotle University which offers a full international program in English for a complete semester. We offer 16 courses in English for the spring semester, which is a balanced blend of both laboratory and theoretical courses. We're also planning to launch an all-English postgraduate master's degree next year. Apart from European exchanges, the school is also very active in international partnerships as well. For example, we have exchanges with the United States and Australia through the GAGI program for environmental journalism. We also take students from Ohio State University and the University of Connecticut. And of course, we would welcome students and staff from the North Dakota State University as well. We also run a summer school on environmental journalism in Crete, which is currently taught in Greek, but we also plan to launch an English program for that as well next year. So you're all very welcome to come and study and teach at the wonderful Mediterranean island of Crete. So just let me say that we very much look forward to the collaboration between our two institutions, and that we would be very happy to continue the conversation we had at the video conference about potential research projects, future plans and activities. Thank you again for your interest and for the efforts that have made this collaboration possible. What follows is a video clip that our students have prepared that features our electronic media laboratory and its facilities. We hope to talk to you again soon, and we wish you every success with your technology expo. Goodbye, and as we say here in Greece, Yassas.
Okay, we will actually skip over the video in the interest of time. But throughout the course of this IT Expo, we are discussing active and flexible learning spaces. And I'd like to share with you one such option. Identical to those I get when I share pictures in Greece of North Dakota sunrises, our sunflower fields, open spaces, and snow. Our collaborators and colleagues these days call home places we're used to seeing only in pictures and videos via technology. But we work better together when we understand each other on a more personal level, when we come to know those places and the people in them as well. I made reference earlier to the next best thing to being there. Sometimes the next best thing is to actually be there. NDSU has a wonderful study abroad program. And to tell us a bit more about that is Tanya Kramer, assistant director of this program. And then Lisa will discuss the next steps in international collaborations and activities.
Thank
So my name is Tanya Kramer. I'm the Assistant Director of Study Abroad. I'm sure many of you know a little bit about Study Abroad or have experienced it yourself. We have opportunities for students to go abroad in a variety of different means. They can do internships, volunteer programs, study, camp apparently. No, this is actually a summer language camp in Greece, which is sounds amazing. And to be on the beach for our students is, you know, a world away from where we live. And those types of experiences can happen in over 74 different countries through collaborations that we have here on campus. Students can go abroad for a variety of lengths of time. They can go abroad for as short as a spring break. So for students who have, you know, structured programs where it's a little bit more difficult to get abroad for an entire semester, spring break, summer programs are great ways for students to meet new acquaintances, network with individuals, and other, you know, if they're studying in a major, even in accounting and things like that, where you wouldn't think, okay, those students need to have an international experience for their future career goals. It does make a difference. They meet people who stretch their boundaries and who they can eventually collaborate with and have ties with for down the road. And one of the things that I'm learning more and more is that, you know, on campus, as we're researching and as we're learning, we have ties everywhere. Everywhere we go, we're making connections with people. And for the students to be able to do that while they're studying, so down the road they can have these connections later in life, it makes a world of difference. Just last night, I was actually communicating with a student who had studied abroad a long time ago, and he's in Australia now. And students who do that, they know to reach out. And he contacted me just to see if there are any job opportunities that I am aware of, because he had worked with me in the past. And it's those types of things, being able to collaborate and reach out to people, that it's an amazing experience. It's one of the things you learn when you study abroad. Beyond it being a wonderful personal experience, it's something that for the career, you know, down the road, it's something that is becoming more and more essential in the global world that we live in today. So.
To follow that, because I heartily agree, and I guess I'd like to say I endorse that. I just would like to come full circle again, I think, on this and say that with this particular collaboration with Aristotle University and NDSU, and really in generally speaking as well, what we like to see is the foundation is laid, and sometimes the foundation goes down rather slowly and painstakingly, one brick at a time, and then there's a pause. I know that that's happened with this institution. Sometimes it can happen quite quickly. But the MOU, which we signed with Aristotle University about a year ago, is the foundational piece of the relationship, in the sense that it's the official handshake that our institutions recognize that we want to explore avenues together and see where we can go. And then the next step is up to, in many cases, the interested, truly interested faculty and staff members. And I know I'm looking at some folks that have delved into collaborations on a deeper level and created partnerships that reflect interests among faculty or classes that are going on. And I think, if I can spill the beans a little bit, I know that we all got handed the information about the next video conference opportunity between NDSU and Aristotle University. That's on November 7th. And that's bringing together both those, I think, who've already participated in the two ones that have been held, one in September and one earlier this month, to see where we might go as colleges and as departments and as programs to see what types of things might be possible between our two institutions. So that's sort of, I think, it's a microcosm of what we do with all of the MOUs that we sign. I think on any given, I'm thinking about football already, so I'm going to say on any given Sunday, but typically at any given time here at NDSU, we probably have well over 100 agreements that are signed between NDSU and other schools. Some of them, most of them are very general. Some of them are memorandum of understanding, excuse me, of agreements or articulation agreements where we have a transfer program set in place, joint PhD degrees, those sorts of things. So the sky's really the limit. So we have those out there, and then, like someone once shared with me, agreements are, and between institutions are very similar to businesses, and you have maybe for every 10 that are signed, we may have one or two that really move forward and become something that's lasting. And so I have a very strong feeling that the agreement between Aristotle University of Thessalonica and NDSU is going to be one of those lasting ones, because I know that there is a personal connection, which is very important, and then we've already seen displayed true interest from a variety of departments across campus. Unfortunately, I feel like I'm batting zero at this point, because I'm going to be out of town on the 7th of November, but I know that someone from our office will be at that video conference, and hopefully many of you will as well. With that, I'll turn it back over and say thank you very much for your interest in globalization and forming international connections. The IT, in my mind, I know it stands for information technology, but I also think of it as international technology too. So have a good afternoon.